we're having our Bible studies on three of the four Fridays, starting right after Labor Day. And the only Friday we'll miss is the first, because I already have a veterans obligation on that every Friday, every first Friday. So, well, if I can get there, I will.
4 to 5.
4 to 5 p.m.
First Wednesday.
So it's 4 p.m. to 5 p.m.
That's correct.
Wow, I thought that would cut into dinner. It doesn't cut into dinner. Just in time for the blue plate special.
Happy hour.
Thank you.
Maybe we'll cut a CD one of these days, huh? How about that, right? We'll cut a CD where she should be at the piano. Well, in case you're wondering, where are these photos? This actually drone video. This is the country of Croatia. Croatia. I always heard it was green and beautiful, so I thought, we're going to find something. And this came up, so we're glad it did. And we're glad that you joined us today here at Heritage Bible Church. We want to welcome you to our worship services as we worship a risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is alive, he is well, and he's coming again, as we are going to recite here in just a few minutes with the Apostles' Creed as you looked at your bulletin. Got a couple things we want to bring to your attention. First of all, happy birthday to our birthday girl, Jimmy Brockbank. These flowers are in honor of her birthday. Thank you so much for purchasing those. Those will go home with you. It's a consolation prize for playing today, so thanks for coming. I'm kidding. You know I'm kidding. It's fun to kid Jimmy. She'll give it right back, too. So that's a good thing. Another announcement is today, as long as it lasts, any of those books that you want to take home and add them to your collection, they're yours to keep. We've tried this book exchange, and it was nice. I liked it. It was a great idea, but we're seeing the idea kind of fade a little bit. So we're going to reduce the inventory, and then whatever's left, we'll donate to the libraries. But take home whatever you want, and they're yours to keep for your collection. Or if you've got a child, grandchild, or great-grandchild, that would be one of those books. Like, there's a book called Decade by Decade over there. It's a little thin paperback. That is a great graduation gift. We gave one to our graduate on our street. She just graduated the local high school, so I gave her a copy of that from Bob Beal, who's actually here in Phoenix. Great book for those young minds. Don't forget the lunch bunch. This is every Sunday. We want to keep this going. So sign up. You can sit with folks after lunch and talk about whatever you want to talk about. Community. Right? And what's new in our lives. It's a chance to sit down with someone that maybe you haven't seen or met. It's a great way to meet new people in the church. And this is every Sunday. The sign-up sheet is right there. So you can't miss it on your way in or your way out. Daily breads are available for you as well. And as I was telling someone, if you've got a friend or a neighbor that would enjoy one, take an extra one. I think we still have some extras in the back. We can get those out. So those are for you. They're large print, and they're available for you there. And then the date is tentative right now. It's either the 19th or the 26th. Those are Saturdays. And the location, I want to change the location to the Desert Willow All-Purpose Room. So some of our folks from that building, it's a little bit easier for them. They're not in the heat. And so we're going to kick this off. We're going to start doing this about every other month or every third month. We want to keep everybody in tune. We want to find out what's going on with your care receiver. And if you're interested in becoming an Acacia Care team member, this is a good spot to come and hang out with us. Jimmy, did you have a question?
Yes. Are you referring to the activity
room? Yeah, the activity room.
Yeah.
I said all-purpose room.
It has a sign on it that says activity.
Activity. Well, I'll tell you what, it's right next to the bathroom that always says it's occupied, but it's lying to you. It's absolutely a liar. And I think it's a bad sense of humor. We need to complain to Ed Smith about that. So, and then this is our call to worship. This is a brand new photo from our one and only beloved Len Bader. He does such a great job. And we want to give a hoot today, right? We want the Lord to hear our hoot and our worship. And we begin with the psalmist. The psalmist reminds us, we are joining the voices of ancient praise. Think about that. Voices from centuries echoed this praise. Psalm 75:1. We thank you, O God. We give thanks because you are near. People everywhere tell of your wonderful deeds. Aren't you grateful the Lord is near? He's near. What does that mean for you today? Well, you think about that as we sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. To join with me. He's got his microphone right there. Bob, you want to help us? You're going to lead it with your microphone right from where you're at. Join in as we recite the Apostles' Creed. Whenever you're ready.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who has conceived of the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
He descended into hell.
The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, our Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, in the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Beautiful. Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much. Let's unite our hearts this morning. Is that refreshing? We haven't done that in a while. And it's kind of nice to repeat the Apostles' Creed every now and then. For those of you, that's part of your tradition. Father God, thank you. Thank you so much for being near. We just got done singing, Lord, that you are right beside us. And that your presence is there to cheer and to guide. What a wonderful promise. We receive the blessings that you have given to us. May we be enriched by those and grow into those each and every day. May you remind us that we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, and that we are the beloved of God, and that we are in Christ. May we be reminded that the fullness of God rested in the person of Jesus Christ, and in him we are made complete. You have given us everything to live a life of godliness and righteousness. You even lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. And so we thank you. We thank you so much because we are called to give thanks. Your word says that it is a sacrifice of praise, our lips giving thanks. It's the fruit of our lips, and you delight in it. Not that you're insecure or need it. It is for our benefit to remind us of how dependent we really are upon you. So we pray for those who are not here today for illness sake. Think of many, Lord. And we ask that you would meet them in their needs. That they would find answers from the doctors. And Lord, that there would be procedures done to allow them to continue to live their life in a way that pleases you. In a way that you want them to continue to walk with you. We're thankful, Lord, for the families that are here today, bringing their loved ones, and our staff members, the caregivers as well. May they be blessed, Lord. From the presence of God, may they be blessed today. And Jesus, you're the audience. We're here to worship you. We're the participants in this worship service. You are the audience as we gather to worship your name. And so we continue that by praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. thank you, O God, the psalmist reminds us. We thank you, O God. We give thanks because you are near. People everywhere tell of your wonderful deeds. Thank you for worshiping. And we continue that now as we open up his word. How many was that new? I saw some faces that weren't singing at the beginning, and then I saw their lips moving at the end, because the tune is kind of catchy after a while. And that came by request. Kay Bader, we thank you, Kay, for doing that. And that was new to Kelly and me. We kind of let it grow on us during the week. And we kept playing it, and we're going, okay, well, yeah. Okay. You can see people dancing at church, maybe. I can't even get you guys to clap your hands. I can't. There's no way I can get you to dance. So we're grateful that you're here. Hey, in 1519, Hernan Cortes took his 600 men to the New World. And after they came across the shore, the men were completely exhausted from the voyage. But he wanted them to be motivated to go on and search for the gold in the New World, because Cortes was passionate about that. That was his obsession. And in order to motivate the men, he did something that no one ever would have dreamed of. Those of you who know the history know exactly what he did. After the men were disembarked and out of the ship and the supplies were out, he burned the ships. Every last one of them. You think, well, why did he do that? Because he wanted to motivate them to go for the gold. And don't even think about once going back to Spain. You know, as we're kind of in this portion of scripture studying about Elijah, he wasn't on a ship. That's Jonah. He was initially on a ship. That's a whole other story. But Elijah, like Cortes, is in a little bit of a dilemma, because he knows he can't do his whole ministry alone. And so God tells him to go and anoint three people. And we discovered that last week. There were two kings, and then go anoint Elisha, because Elisha is going to be his protege that will eventually take over for him. And we're going to get into that in just a minute. But he had to learn something. Elijah had to learn something that I think is so relevant and so practical for you and me today and for Heritage Bible Church. I don't want us to miss it. Because in this process, Elijah and Elisha both have to face the very similar dilemma. It's very parallel to what we have to face. And that is, in order for us to go forward, in order for us to move forward as a church and prepare the next generation, we too will have to burn a couple ships. We too are gonna have to look at some things and say, we've gotta get those things out of our mind so we're focused on moving forward. Don't worry, there won't be any open flames in the room. My Bible's open to 1 Kings chapter 19, if you're there. I'm at the last three verses of the chapter, 19, 20, and 21. And before we go there, I just want to tell you, why are we doing this? Why are we talking about preparing the next generation, as it says here? Well, first of all, the Bible tells us throughout Scripture, from the beginning of time with Moses, when he begins to lead the people across the desert, he had Aaron and Hur who were helping him out, but the guy that stayed by his side throughout the whole time, and you can trace this starting in Exodus 24 all the way to Joshua chapter 1, verse 1, the guy that stayed with him was Joshua. And he was called the servant of Joshua, of Moses. He was an administrator. He was, an intern for him. That might be a better 21st century term that we would understand. So the first thing is, the Bible talks about this. Jesus said, go and make disciples. And that refers to training up new generation to be prepared to operate and run the church. So when we are passed on, there's this whole new generation equipped and ready to take the next step. And that's what we're preparing for, starting today, Lord willing. Second reason is there's an identity crisis in our culture, is there not? Actually, there's identity theft, not just the kind that steals off the internet, but in our generations that are living right now, people don't know who they are. People have no idea who they really are. And they're searching here and searching there and identify as this today. And tomorrow they identify as a plant or a front screen door. People are identifying as all kinds of weird stuff today. There is a huge identity crisis in our culture. And it's even here. Because as we age, and you have been, I'll say you because I'm still trying to understand what that means. You guys are have reached personal and financial success to one degree or another. And now some of us are asking the question, is this all there is? Like the old song, is that all there is? Is it? Or does God have something else for you? I believe he does. It's more than personal success. It's more than financial success. It's more than anything the world can offer. It's an eternal value that God wants to do in and through each and every one of us. Whether it's on a small scale or a grand scale, doesn't matter. God wants to use you in some form or fashion. So the third reason is, how are we going to do this when this is the third reason? Our culture is full of distractions. I mean, if it's not a cell phone, it's Netflix, because we can stream anything we want to. How are we going to do this when everyone is so distracted? It's going to take focus. It's going to take precision. So again, my Bible's open to 1 Kings 19, and I'm going to read these first three verses, and then we're going to go back and focus on them, okay? Here we go. Verse 19 of 1 Kings chapter 19. So he departed from there. This is Elijah. Departed from where? He departed from the cave. And he found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, while he was plowing, with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he with the 12th. And Elijah came over to him and threw his cloak on him. Then he left the oxen behind and ran after Elijah and said, "Please let me kiss my father and my mother, then I will follow you." And he said to him, that means Elijah said to Elisha, "Go back, for what have I done to you?" So he returned from following him, took the pair of oxen, sacrificed them, and cooked their meat with the implements of the oxen, and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he got up and followed Elijah and served him. Father, as we open your word, Spirit of God, be our teacher. We open ourselves up to whatever you want to say to us. Create in us a clean heart and a resolved will for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. There's three notable observations I find here with Elisha, as we're following our outline. Number one, Elisha was called to ministry. This is Elisha, not Elijah, who we've been studying. Shah. Maybe we should call him Shah and Jah, but still going to be confusing. So just remember, Elijah, J, comes before Elisha, S, right in the alphabet. Elijah, Elisha. All right? Elisha is the protege. Here's three observations about this young guy. Number one, he was called when he was doing ordinary activity. Here in verse 19, we see that he's farming his parents' land. He's working with servants. He's plowing the land. He's working an ordinary job in an ordinary place. Why is this so interesting? Because if he is supposed to take over for Elijah, shouldn't he be in the school of prophets that they've had by this time? Well, yeah, you would think so. So in other words, he's not a seminary grad. He doesn't have his PhD, or as my dad would call, the paper hanger and decorator degree. And so, yeah, that's a whole other story. But you would think if a guy's going to get called to be a prophet, he would be in that track, preparing himself to be a prophet. And God says no. And that's a lesson right there. We can't look at the obvious. We have to look for the people God wants us to select. And that's a whole lot different than who we would normally select. Remember when David came to be selected as the king? And Samuel came to David's home, and everybody was there. But where was David? He was out tending sheep. In fact, they forgot about him. Because the Lord says, no, it's none of these guys. And so Samuel goes, is there anybody else in the house? And Obed goes, oh yeah, by the way, where is David? I mean, that's his response. Oh, that's right, we got another guy. He's way out in the field. We'll go get him. And he's the one that they anoint. Isn't that interesting how God doesn't select who we think? 1 Corinthians 1:26 and following, Paul says, notice many of you were not wise when you were called to the kingdom of God. Not many of you were this or that, but God chose the weak things to confound the strong and the wise things to confuse the wise. God loves to do miraculous through the ordinary. That's why I don't have a problem calling myself the mutt of Christianity. I'm a Heinz 57 dog, right? I really am. And it doesn't really matter because I take glory in the fact that it's not me. When I get up here and do what I do, it's not me. It's what God is doing in and through me to you. And that's a great dynamic because nothing gives me more joy than seeing God work in and through me, speaking to you and seeing you dynamically change for the kingdom of God. Spend more time on that than I wanted to. Elisha was called not only in ordinary activity, but also obscurity. He's on a farm. Nobody knows about this guy. Thirdly, he was called in apparent prosperity. He's got 12 sets of oxen plowing this field. If you look here, 12 yoke of oxen, and with him, he's got servants. And he is set soon to inherit all of that. His parents are elderly, more than likely, and they too will pass on. And they're getting ready to pass on into glory. And he knows that this is all his. He basically had it made. The keys to the business were going to be dropped in his hand. He had everything he needed financially. He was set to be successful financially and ready to go. And all of a sudden this happens. Well, what happens? Well, let's look at Elijah. Verse 19. At the end of it, he says, Elijah came over to him and threw his cloak on him. Now you say, well, what in the world is that? Was Elisha cold? You know, was it starting to rain and he was kind of being nice? No, there's none of that here. So what's going on? The cloak was something Elijah the prophet wore. In fact, most prophets wore this. Remember when Jesus was walking the earth, he had the rabbi's shawl on him, and so people understood he was a rabbi. They would call him rabbi. There was a cloak that the prophets wore. Specifically, Elijah had one. In fact, King Ahab recognized him from afar and said, is that you, you troublemaker? That's how he identifies Elijah. But he knew it was Elijah because of his cloak. 1 Kings chapter 21:20. And it's the very cloak that Elijah would leave to Elisha when the Lord took him home in the chariot. You've heard that song. So that's the first observation. He threw his cloak on Elijah. Didn't say a word. He just threw his cloak. Now you think, well, what's that like? That would be like the man who mentored to me walked up to me one day, the pastor of my church in Cleveland, Ohio, Bill Davis, who's with the Lord now. And he said, Paul, here's the keys to my office with all the books, with all my tools. God's calling you. Here it is. That's the gravity of the situation. You catching it now? That's the gravity of the situation when he throws the cloak on top of Elisha's shoulders. So what happens here? What happens? God is asking Elisha, will you be my spokesperson? Will you be my prophet in lieu of Elijah when I take him home? All of a sudden, he's got a 900-pound gorilla resting on his shoulder. You want me to do what? Think about that. You want me to take over Elijah's? I know what's happened to him. He's notorious. Ahab and Jezebel had a contract on his life. You want me to do that? I don't know, Lord. I'm going to have to, well, let's find out what happens. How does Elisha respond? Look at verse 20 and 21. He ran after Elijah and he said, please let me kiss my father and mother. In other words, he's kind of waffling here a little bit. He's saying, well, I do want to honor my parents, which is a commendable thing. You've got to commend Elisha. That was ingrained into him to honor. That's the first commandment with the promise, isn't it? Honor your father and mother, for this is the commandment with the promise, that it may go well with you and you may inherit the land. He's honoring God and he's honoring his parents. You got to give him a hats off for that. And that's what he's saying here. Hey, what about that commandment? But notice how Elisha responds here. He said, go back, verse 20 at the end. What have I done to you? Go back. Now, this is really weird because it's a Hebrew idiom that I'm not familiar with, and there's scholars and experts that disagree. But if you look at the context here, what might Elijah, put your exegetical creative thinking cap on for a minute. All right, mine's kind of a leather deal. It's imaginary. It's a leather deal. It's got a chin strap, you know, with the goggles like a World War I pilot, right? That's my exegetical thinking cap. Context tells me that Elijah's going, Elisha, let me remind you, this isn't about you and me. I put my cloak on you. This is between you and God. God is calling you, not me. God is calling you. See the difference? See, when we prepare the next generation, it's not about us calling them. It's about God calling them to step up, to be part of this ministry, to take over the mantle, if you will, and say, I will help serve, key word, serve the church. We got enough leaders. We need servants, people who will put their shoulder behind the wheel and keep moving forward. So he says, you know, it's between you and God. So what happens? How does Elisha respond? It's pretty interesting. Verse 21. So he returned from following him, took the pair of oxen, and sacrificed. He burned the ships. He took his inheritance and went. That's exactly what he did. He took the car keys back and the company car keys and the company checking account and credit card, and he said, Mom, Dad, I'm accepting a call into ministry. You're going to have to find someone else to take over the business. That is a very hard step for children to take, to face their parents who are planning on that their son, their daughter, would take over the business. It's not an easy conversation. It's challenging. And so that's what he does. He burns the ships. Isn't that amazing? I mean, this is no easy feat, beloved. You say, well, what in the world does this have to do with us? We're not Elijah. How does this relate to 21st century? How does it relate to what I'm worried about, what I'm concerned about? It has everything to do. Because this church will cease to exist if we don't begin to plant the process. And we are. To a great degree, we are. But is there something else God wants us to do? How does God want us to prepare? First of all, how does he want us to partner with him? That's the key word, partner with him, follow him, to prepare the next generation for Heritage Bible Church. Well, there's three things that the Lord shows from this text, shows each and every one of us, both from Elijah and Elisha. And the first one is, if we're going to prepare the next generation, it's going to require us by burning our ships, a couple of them. First one is, we got to burn our time. It's going to take time to seek out the face of God and say, God, where are you leading the church? What direction are you helping us go? Who do you want us to invite to partner with us, like Elijah invited Elisha? Those are the questions that don't come from a brief from a 30-second prayer. It requires stillness. It requires removing distractions, as we will see. Elijah heard the voice of God not when things were rumbling, not when the earthquake came, not when the fire came, not when the strong wind, almost a tornado, came through and tore apart the mountain. It came in the what? The still, small voice. You see why distractions are a problem from us hearing the voice of God? We've got to remove those. Volitionally remove the distractions. We got to not only burn the ship that's called time, but also our talent. We have to give what God has given to us and impart that to these new leaders coming up. Let me show you how to do that. Let me show you what we do. You can do it any way you want to. Maybe you've got another creative way to do it, and that's fine. But here's how we set up. Here's how we tear down. Here's how we set up communion. Here's how we tear down. Here's how we do acacia care team. Here's how we do a follow-up phone call. All of that. You've heard the adage, more is caught than taught. We need apprenticeships and people that are willing to spend time investing their time and talent into others. You see the challenge? You see how you're part of that solution? How God wants you to be part of this solution in some form, some fashion? And the third one, you can probably guess already, we need to burn the ship at church. It's going to cost money. And you guys have been so faithful. When was the last time you heard me give an exact message only on money? For those of you who are guests, I can probably answer that question. But those of you who have been here for 5 years with me, how many times have I given a message only on money? Close your eyes. What do you see? I have alluded to it, but I have never given a message. And you know why? Because I believe the promise in Galatians 6 that if you are fed spiritually, you will remunerate the church. You will give back to the church how God is blessing you spiritually. I believe that with all my heart. In fact, about 2 or 3 years ago, we were running a deficit back in the spring of that year. And there was concern that we need to do a message. And I inquired the elder board, asked them permission, and said, can we wait? And I shared this promise with them. And we just all prayed about it. And within 2 or 3 months, I don't have the exact time, we were not only running in the black, but we were far exceeding where we were supposed to be by the end of the year. God keeps his promises. God keeps his word. And that's the message. God wants us to partner with these three ships that we need to burn. It's going to help us partner with the Lord and move on. Elisha seems to have passed the test. Wouldn't you say so? He definitely passed the test. I want Heritage Bible Church to pass the test. I want to pass the test. The secret is we need to begin listening to the voice of God. Well, how do we do that? Well, as I mentioned, Elijah didn't hear it in all the racket. He heard it when the still small voice came through. That's what drew him out of the cave and back into ministry. What did Elisha hear? Did Elijah say anything to him? No. It was a symbolic gesture by putting his cloak on Elisha's shoulders. He didn't say a word. The first person that broke the silence was Elisha, because he knew exactly what the message was. Beloved, God's priority for us is to have such an intimate relationship with him that we can pause together and hear that still small voice. To remove the distractions, to break away from the day-to-day humdrums and schedules and say, God, we're going to sit here in silence and we're going to wait to hear from you. I don't expect to hear an audible voice. But those of you who know Christ as your Savior, you have the Holy Spirit within you. And I believe in that circle of prayer, God will speak in and through one or several of us of what the direction we need to go into. But it's going to require burning a few ships, folks. Our time, our talent, and our treasure. The bottom line is this. Jesus Christ said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. We're on the winning side, guys. But he's asking us and calling us to partner with him to build that church. And it begins by preparing the next generation. So, are we open to removing the distractions so we can hear the voice of God? Will you join me? Because this is what I believe that God is calling us to. In the name of Jesus, Father God, we come before you. Give us ears to hear, hearts to receive, and wills to respond to your will, your word. In the name, the blessed name, the one who is near to us, the one who is building his church, Jesus Christ. Amen. good singing. Our benediction is from the Apostle Paul to the church in Corinth. I'll recite it the way that, well, I'll do it this way so I don't confuse you. I haven't memorized it in the New King James. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Isn't that a great promise? God wants to use us. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works. He's not done with us, folks. Retirement is not in his vocabulary. You go with God. He goes with you. Have a great week.